Hello everyone, welcome to another Rebots episode. In this video, we will learn the basics about how to move a KUKA Car C4 industrial robot. First of all, there are mainly two types of cabinets. I say two because they can be big and small. By this, I mean small like this one compact, or a big one with two or more servo drivers that can be seen. You can see in this picture, the servo drivers are the white boxes, the two white boxes on the top right. So let's start with the main connectors. X21 is the data cable, it's square. Then you have the power cable for the robot, which is the X20. The power supply cable is the black one. In a compact, it's a single phase and it's the same voltage as you would use in a home appliance. In a big cabinet, it's a Harting Hand 6 metal plug, the connector on the far left, and it carries trifacic current. So going back to our compact cabinet, we have the smart part connector, which is round and it's SpringTech TX19. And finally, we have the safety signals on the X11. This one is a DB50 connector, an old serial and parallel connector. In a standard controller, we have a 108-pin Harting connector. I will link the jumper diagram down below in the description. So let's turn on the cabinet and learn how to move our KUKA robot. Here in my hand, I have a KUKA smart pad. Most hitch pendants have an enabling handbrake. KUKA in particular has three. You will also need to select manual mode T1. To do that, you use the physical selector and rotate the key switch. Then four buttons will appear, T1, T2, auto and external. You select T1. Right now, I'm changing user group mode because I have my KUKA robot controlled externally. So with a user mode with more privileges, you go into startup, service, startup mode. These are the handbrakes. They have two positions. If you push hard, it goes into the second position. If you push soft, it goes into the first position. The first position is the one that enables movement and everything turns green in the screen. It is designed to stop the robot's movement immediately in case of accident. Some people tend to tense their muscles and grip harder, and others lose control of their muscles and let go. The green button next to the handbrake is a start button. It's equivalent to the play forward or play backwards on the front of the smart pad. If you have a program selected, it will start the program. So let's move the robot now. Let's change the speed first. To change the manual mode speed, you go into the hand icon and press the button plus. Now you will notice the movements better. Let's see. So simply press the handbrake to the first position and everything will light green. Then you will just need to select the axis and move. As you can see in the video, I'm just moving all of the axes. The icons refer to the first axis, second axis, third axis, and so on. You can move each axis accordingly. The play button under the 6th axis is the speed for automatic mode. And on the top, we have the mouse. The mouse is predetermined to move in world coordinates, which means the X, Y, Z axis. So let's go back to axis movements. As the name suggests, it moves every single axis individually. You will see a small indication on the arm of the robot. As you can see on the 5th arm, less is upwards and plus is downwards. Every single axis will have a plus or minus to indicate the direction of the turn. So we have four different types of movements: joint movements, whorl movements, face movements, and tool movement. The difference between these three last ones is the reference of position. Whorl is global positioning. If you stand in front of a robot, it will move in the direction of the mouse movement. Like you will see now. You will be standing parallel to the x-axis. In base mode, you can change this plane's position, and in tool movement, you will move according to an offset of the dimension of the distance of the tool. Instead of turning around the wrist, it will turn around the point that has been given, in my case, the tip of the gripper. If I rotate the mouse, you can follow the movement as I am rotating the direction of the smart pad. Let's talk a bit about the mouse. The mouse is six-directional movement. You can move every single axis. Also, in whorl movement in the default mode, it goes X, Y, Z, positive and negative, and the angles in between the planes, A, B, and C. also positive and negative. If you have been looking closely to my hand movement, the robot is doing the same movement as you can see right now. Let's talk about the interface of the Teach Pendant. Here on the top, we can see three squares. The first one is the submit, which tells you if the robot program has compiled well. The second one is the on and off. It's the standard open circuit and closed circuit. It tells you if the drives are on or off. And last but not least, the square R. It represents the programming state. You can reset the program or cancel the program. If the program is selected, the square will be yellow. On the right hand side, we have the movements. On the top, it's the mouse movement. If we select the world, we can change the default movement of the mouse. If we select the robot, we will select the axis movement type, and we can change it also into world, base, or tool. On the top, next to the three squares, we have the speed. We can change the auto program speed and the Yogi manual speed. To change the speed, we can use the virtual buttons or the slider or the physical buttons on the bottom right of the smart pad. On the left, we can see the Word Visual project that is selected currently. And if you click on open, you can see other projects that have been installed in the robot. For example, I have a few that have less signals program, just the gripper or just the conveyor when I was doing tests. Right now, I have all controlled by the PLC, and the KUKA also is controlled through auto external. That's why I have a startup mode selected. To start a program, first we select the program in the file explorer. Then if we are in auto mode, we go to the three top squares on the top, and between S and R, we enable the drives, and then you just press play. In manual mode, it's just the same. You just need to maintain both the handbrake and the play button. The robot will probably not be on the first position. So first it will reach the start position, and then it will stop. And we'll need you to confirm that you want to start the program. So you press play again, and the robot starts moving. In this program, we can see two different types of movements, PTP and linear. PTP movements try to move as fast as they can to the next point. So normally they don't take into account the trajectory. Linear movements, as you can see, they will follow a straight path. And normally they are taught slash programmed using world-based tool movements. So more or less, you will see the path that we will take. You won't be able to use this type of movements if the robot hasn't been adjusted, or as other people know it, calibrated. To stop the program in manual mode, release the play button. And in auto mode, just press the universal red square, which means stop. Now, if you want to control the robot through a PLC, you will need to change some signals. You have to go into configuration, inputs and outputs, automatic external, and follow my other guide that I have about KUKA auto external. Here, as you can see, I have a move enabled change into a PLC signal input. So that's why even if I press the handbrake, the drives won't start. So if I put startup mode and press on the handbrake, it goes green. So now we're going to do the same example, but without the startup mode. We will change move enable into 1025, which is always on. And then we will be able to move the robot only if we have the jumper connection in the X11. Normally, these signals are used with barriers or emergency stops, but since we don't have them, we need to jumper all of the signals and close the circuit. I will leave the circuit diagram in the description below, like I said. If you have any doubts, just leave a question in the comment section below, or go into our website and go into the forum and make a post. On the right-hand side, you have a summary of the signal sequenced to use auto external. If you want to know which program I use for the remote desktop and to see the smart pad on my computer, it's UltraVNC. You will need to configure the IP address and add some ports. I will make a tutorial in the future. And as always, if you like this video, please like and subscribe. See you in the next video.